The UCLA Bruins are looking to win their fourth straight Pac-10 Women's Gymnastics Championship. There were many emotional moments last year as UCLA had an NCAA record score of 195.20. This year, the Bruins are led by senior Jill Andrews, who has the best all-around score in the Pac-10 Conference, a 39.05. Her best score on the bars this season is 9.7. Oregon State is the second seed in the meet. The Beavers' Joy Selig is the Pac-10 defending champion in the all-around. She scored a 39.35 last year. Her career best on the beam, a 9.9. Diane Monty is Arizona's top performer in the all-around with a season best of 38.65. The Wildcats are seeded number 3 tonight. Arizona State has a star performer in Susie Baldock. She posted a season best 38.50 in the all-around last weekend against Arizona. All the excitement of the 1990 Pac-10 Women's Gymnastics Championship coming up next on the Prime Network. From Harmon Gymnasium in Berkeley, California, the Prime Network presents the 1990 Great Western Bank Pac-10 Women's Gymnastics Championships. Hello again, everybody. I'm Jeff Witcher. We've got a great meet for you tonight. This is traditionally an all-time event here in the Pac-10, and although UCLA is the number one seed looking to win their fourth straight, they are not a shoe-in. We'll, of course, keep you up to date on the team standings, and the individual all-around champion also will be spotlighted on our telecast tonight. Let's find out more about it from my broadcasting partner, Kathy Johnson. And this is such a well-balanced conference. This should be some kind of a meet tonight.
It certainly will be. The Pac-10 is definitely one of the strongest gymnastics conferences in the nation. In fact, they realistically have 4 teams that could qualify for the Nationals in April. And even though there are 7 strong teams competing here, I think the top 4 teams will probably be Arizona and Arizona State, who are very closely matched, and Oregon State and UCLA. UCLA, however, is forced to compete without one of their top all-arounders, Kim Hamilton. And that could very well open the door just enough for Oregon State or one of the 2 schools from Arizona.
There are so many outstanding individuals. I know it's almost impossible to pinpoint a few, but if we had to just pick 2 to keep an eye on tonight, who would they be?
Well, there certainly are a lot of good all-arounders here, but if I have to pick 2, keep an eye out on the defending Pac-10 national champion, Joy Selig. Not only did she win the all-around, but she tied for first in 3 events. Now, her major competition will be Jill Andrews from UCLA. She has scored now twice this season the highest all-around score in the conference. She's a very determined and has probably the most difficult routines here. So I think it'll be a close competition, but if any one of those make a mistake, there are several others ready to take those spots.
And this has traditionally been a high-scoring meet. Do you expect the same tonight?
I certainly do, because many of these schools are trying to qualify for the Nationals, and the national qualifying system requires each school to count 2 away meets, 2 home meets, 2 wild card meets, and then, of course, the regional scores. So they're all trying to get the highest scores possible, and I'm sure we're going to see those here.
It should be exciting. I'm sure we'll have a lot of drama for you. Glad you could join us from the Harmon Gym in Berkeley, California, the Pac-10 Women's Gymnastics Championships coming up. Gymnastics Championships. Well, when Kathy Johnson says this is a great conference, she wasn't whistling Dixie. As we take a look at the top teams, we have UCLA ranked 6th from the Pac-10, Utah, Alabama, Georgia, Nebraska, Louisiana State ahead of UCLA. Oregon State is 7, Arizona 8, Cal State Fullerton 9, Missouri, Arizona State from the Pac-10 ranked 11. Then Florida at the number 12 slot. First event, the bars, and our first competitor, Jennifer McMullen from OSU.
Jennifer has really turned out to be one of their strong all-arounders. She's been very consistent for them throughout the year. And she really doesn't have a real weak event. She's pretty consistent throughout.
Her season best mark, 9.45. Her career best, a 9.55.
you know, when we took a look at those rankings, it's so hard throughout the year to compare these schools because many of them don't compete against each other to get this ranking. So it's hard to tell until it finally boils down to the Nationals in April exactly where their ranking should be. But they have to have a system in order to qualify, and that's the best one that they can come up with.
In a meet like this, Kathy, I would imagine some butterflies.
Well, this is a big competition for them. There's a lot riding here. UCLA has won it the last 3 years in a row. Of course, they're going to try and make it a fourth one in a row. But Oregon State has really come up in the last 3 years. Nice original mount. Not of major difficulty, but the judges also look for unique moves. A tuck stinger. It's a flyaway with a half twist and perfect regrasp. Oh, I saw trouble there. Oh, no. She was in trouble much before the fall actually occurred. Now, they have to count that fall if someone else doesn't score higher. That's important in the team competition. And a layout full twist. Each of the teams can drop one low score from each event. Their first girl up, hit the routine. Of course, this routine will score much lower. You see the problem here. She's trying to undershoot to a handstand low bar, and she is just way off. When you get in a position like that, it's just safety first. You get in a position where you can just get off the bar safely.
Jennifer McMullen of Oregon State. In the meet, we'll have seven rotations, and there are seven schools, so three teams have byes. And in the first rotation, UCLA, Arizona, Arizona State draw byes.
Now, it's really important for the team here to make up for that, and that's what's good about watching the college teams. They really kind of take up the slack for others. If somebody has a weak event or has a poor routine, the next person comes up and just tries to lift from that and get them back on the momentum that they had built from the first routine.
An 8.80 for Jennifer McMullen. Donna Linder is up next for Oregon State, sophomore.
There's a little bit of pressure here now that they have a miss. All the rest of the girls really want to try and hit the routines. Giant swing to a reverse hex. She has beautiful form. Watch how her toes always stay pointed. The legs are always straight. You don't want to give away any tenth of a point in form deductions. And dismount, the toe on front. Very nice. Ample difficulty. She had the one release move in the middle of the routine. But most importantly here, she doesn't give away tenths of a point because of bad form.
Her season and career best, 9.7.
It's not one of the most spectacular routines you'll see here today, but it was nice and clean and had just enough difficulty.
Donna Linder. Waiting the news of her score.
Last year at this competition, UCLA came up with a big score, a 195.2, which was an NCAA record at that time. And so you can see many of the teams really point to this competition. It's a great warm-up for the Nationals.
Donna scores a 9.35. Linda Pierce up next for Oregon State.
Giant swing with a full pirouette. Nice position on top of the bar. To a full twisting flyaway. Now, she didn't have a big release move in her routine, but because of the rules that the judges are using here, it's called competition two rules, it's a little bit easier to get your bonus point, and there's a possibility of 4/10 of a point bonus in the 10.0 total. Here's her underswing over the low bar. And as I said, they don't need the big elements to get the minimum amount to have their routine scored from a 10.
Lindy Perry, this season, her best on the bar is a 9.65. Her career best, 9.80.
Of course, you can remember what it's like to wait for that score. It's nerve-wracking at times, isn't it?
It's very nerve-wracking, especially when you know that the team competition is going to be close. Oregon State actually upset UCLA earlier this year in their dual competition. So they know it's very possible to beat UCLA. UCLA, however, has improved since then.
A 9.4 for Linda Pierce. Amy Durham is up next for the Beavers of Oregon State. She's a freshman out of Salt Lake City, Utah.
Giant swing to a giant swing full. That's one of the moves. Oh, nice combination. To a giant swing full right through to a tucked ginger. One of the things the judges are looking for is back-to-back difficulty. An original element. And a layout with a full twist. None of them have really difficult dismounts. But as I said earlier, that the name of the game in gymnastics is consistency. You have to put together a group of routines that they know they're going to hit. There was that giant with a full twist and the tucked ginger, or the tucked flyaway half. In order to be competitive at the Nationals, the girls are going to have to be doing one, two, and sometimes three release moves in their routine. And they need a little bit more difficulty on the dismounts. Many of the girls are doing double flyaways and double twisting flyaways.
Jim Turpin, the fine head coach at Oregon State in his fifth year.
Jim has done an excellent job with his team over the past few years. There was a time when they weren't even qualifying to the Nationals.
And they're very proud to be hosting the NCAA Women's Gymnastics National Championships April 20th and 21st. Amy Durham scores a 9.4.
They have nice middle range scores, but I really think they're going to need a lot bigger scores to compete against the other teams.
Here's Joyce Selig.
Joyce, we mentioned earlier, one of the strongest all-arounders here. Nice move, giant swing, going the other direction, right into a Jaeger front. Whoa, trouble there, major trouble. She had caught a little bit off on her release move from the high bar and could not drop to the low bar properly. Now see, the Oregon State team will have to count a fall now on this event. That's too bad. And a tuck double flyaway. See, she has much more difficulty in the routine, the release move and the difficulty on the dismount, but that fall is going to hurt them. This is very unlike Joy. She is usually very consistent on every event. Here's where the problem was. She got her hands on the bar late onto the high bar and lost her rhythm dropping to the low bar. And of course the dismount, she does a giant swing to a tucked double back flyaway. And a little hop on the landing. But that major break is what's going to hurt Oregon State.
A disappointed Joy Selig. Her best on the bars this year, a 9.75. Her career best, 9.90. So a rough start for Oregon State in this Pac-10 championship. Awaiting Joy Selig's score. While we wait for Selig's score, we're going to move on to the balance beam where Cal is performing. Selig gets an 8.95 for Oregon State. Here's Mimi Goyer, the freshman for California.
She did a very difficult round off that handspring mount. Mimi was one of the top junior elites in the country before she started her collegiate career. Oh, excellent. Round off, layout, step out. A very difficult pass. Very few of the collegiate gymnasts are doing passes of that difficulty. Nice leap pass. One of the requirements the judges are looking for on the balance beam, combining the dance elements. She has such a beautiful style. Aerial cartwheel. She's always one of my favorite gymnasts in the elite program. A beautiful dance. Very nice performance quality. Now, even though many people have seen that move done now internationally by some of the top gymnasts in the world, I believe Mimi was the first person to ever do that skill down on the balance beam. One of her original elements. Biggest excellent routine so far. Gainer back handspring, back handspring. Outstanding routine so far in the dismount. Round off full twist. Good routine.
A wonderful performance by the freshman, Mimi Goyer, on the balance beam for Cal.
This was absolutely gorgeous. Round off, layout step out with perfect form and a perfect landing. The dismount was a round off layout with a full twist and just one slight hop on the landing. She knows she's done a good job here.
So Mimi delighted. The rest of her teammates also very happy. And fifth year coach Pam Burgess has to be thrilled with that performance.
Very difficult to start out on the balance beam. Sometimes it can work for you. If you go out and everyone hits the routine, it puts a lot of pressure on all the teams that have to follow on that event. But it is very nerve-wracking when you start at the beginning of a competition, you have all this adrenaline, you have to control.
The score for Mimi Goyer, a 9.55. Nicely done. We go now to the floor. Becky Ashton of Stanford is up for the Cardinals. Stanford ranked 27th nationally. Ashton, some experience, a senior from Southern California, Agoura.
Setting up for her first tumbling run. Opens with a full and a half twist. Stanford does not have the same level of difficulty as the other teams in this competition. They've been improving over the last few years. Middle tumbling run is a front, through to a full twist. Of course, there's the change of pace that's required. As I mentioned earlier, in the judging system, each of the routines are scored from a 9.6 unless they have originality or extra difficulty in the routine to get the 4/10 of a point bonus. And a very nice exercise. Naturally, as I said, not enough difficulty in this routine, but clean movement, nice expressive dance.
Becky's best score on the floor this season is a 9.10.
For the front, through to a full twist for her middle tumbling run. To really be competitive at the Nationals, these girls have to try and do the double backs and the double fulls and finish with more difficult passes. And she ended with a full twist.
And she ends up with a score of 8.90 for Stanford, Becky Ashton. So Oregon State gets off to a slow start on the bars, and we're going to have more Berkeley, California, right after this. We pick up the vault where UCLA is competing. There's their head coach, Jerry Tomlinson, in his 11th year at the helm. And this is Laura Neustetter, a junior from Sunnyvale, California.
UCLA is really one of the strongest vaulting teams in the country. They have a lot of very difficult vaults. So full twist on, full twist off. And that vault is scored from a 9.9. That's the value of the vault. And the judges will then take the deductions for form and execution from that score.
Tomlinson talking it over with Neustetter, who last year had a 9.45 in the Pac-10 championship meet.
This vault was actually a little bit flat. She needs more height on the pre-flight so she can finish that twist before she makes contact with the horse. Of course, she was a little off center and had to step forward and off to the side. All of those will be deductions. Definitely wants to improve on this vault. They started out very strong. Renee Kelly with a 9.5 on a handspring front vault. In this competition, you can perform the same vault twice. The best score counts of the two. Much better vault. Again, the slight hop off to the side, but it had a lot more height, a lot more distance from the horse.
She seems to be pleased. Laura Neustetter of UCLA.
You'll see where this vault was much better than her first. She gets more height, so she gets that twist around. She's straighter with the horse, much more distance, and only that slight hop off. She will get a deduction because it still could be a little bit higher on both the pre-flight and after-flight.
Laura Neustetter awaits her score for UCLA, who last year, as we mentioned, set an NCAA record with a score of 195.20. Her score, 9.55.
UCLA will really miss Kim Hamilton on this event. She was actually a former national champion on the vault, as they will miss her in the all-around and for the team competition. This is Carol Ulrich, though, and she's moved up into the second all-around spot.
She sprained her left foot yesterday in practice, and we'll see if it has a negative effect on her tonight. She has made great improvement this season.
She definitely has. She's an excellent gymnast. She was an elite competitor before she went to UCLA. And Asukahara with a full twist. One of the more difficult vaults being done in collegiate competition, and particularly at this competition. She had a little form deduction on the pre-flight. I've seen Carol get a little bit higher on the after-flight. As you can see right here, the legs slightly separate on the on-flight. And she could definitely be higher. You like to see that somersault finish above the level of the horse. But she has a nice clean twist and a good tuck position there. And a nice landing.
What do you do to get more height?
Well, she needs a little bit more speed into the horse. And usually most vaulters improve on the second vault because they get a little bit more warmed up for the second one.
Her first vault got scored a 9.45.
The key to getting more height off the horse is not just the speed, but being able to redirect the speed forward from the run upward after you block off the horse right here. Much better. And look at the landing. It's so crucial, particularly in team competition, when sometimes a tenth of a point separates the leader from second place. You don't want to give away a tenth of a point by hopping on your landing. This was a much better vault. It was cleaner on the pre-flight. Still slight leg separation, but much better position in the air and a better landing. Nice, strong vault.
She gets a 9.60. Carol Ulrich of UCLA.
A lot of pressure on this freshman, as I said, because of Kim Hamilton and Sean McGinnis's injury. She has moved into the second all-around spot for UCLA.
Here's Jill Andrews. Keep an eye on this senior.
This is one of the most beautiful vaults being performed in collegiate gymnastics today. She does a handspring front pike. She's done it for years and has just perfected it. It's a very difficult vault to land because it's a blind landing. You don't see the floor until it hits you. Beautiful vault in the air, but a giant step on the landing. That's something she wants to try and correct for her second vault.
Jerry Tomlinson gives her a couple of tips. She tied for fifth on the vault last year.
beautiful pike position in the air. She just needs to open up a little bit sooner so she can go for that stick. And you can see she's a little bit off center on that mat. But just a few weeks ago at the UCLA Invitational, I watched her score a 9.95 on this event.
She got a 9.8 for that vault.
Wow. She's in a position where she could get a big score here if she just sticks it. That's a big score with a major step on the landing. Whoops, he was going for the stick, but couldn't quite do it. You can see in the air, she's thinking stick right here. She opens up like she should. She didn't quite have the same rotation. She didn't have the same height or distance on that ball. Sometimes when you're trying for a stick, you can be a little too conservative because you don't want to over-rotate it.
Her second vault was a 9.75, so 9.8 for Jill Andrews on the vault for UCLA. We go now to the floor exercise, Arizona State, Susie Baldock.
Susie has just done a tremendous job this year. She's a very strong all-arounder, very consistent.
They know her well up in Northern California, a San Jose product.
She opens with a front through to a double back. Good landing. Very nice opening. She's definitely one of the strongest gymnasts Arizona State has ever had. And as they get into the national competition, when they're competing against the likes of Alabama and LSU, where the girls are doing much more difficult routines, it's going to be hard to score as high. This was a beautiful pass. And this is where she got all her originality and her difficulty, right there in that one pass.
Her best score on Florex this season, a 9.7. I'm not sure if she's able to top it with this performance.
It's hard to get those big scores not having the level of difficulty. But if the routine is clean and there are no deductions and they have their minimal qualifications.
9.60 for Susie Baldock of Arizona State. We'll stay right here with the floor exercise. Marika LeSueur is up now for the Sun Devils, a senior from Salt Lake City, Utah.
That's what can be difficult, standing there waiting for your music to begin. Choreography. Their assistant coach is Lisa Zeiss, who's a world championship team member for the United States, also a competitor at